everybody, and welcome back to the Rewatch Project with Hannah and Mike. Gosh, it feels like you're really far away from the microphone.
That's because we don't have my office in the lounge.
Well, I'm sure that we can, through the magic of post-production...
Am I loud enough?
You're registering. So...
Yeah, but the waves for you look like freaking massive. And
yeah,
the waves
that,
for me are like...
Yeah, but what I do is I put it through a software called Levelator, where basically it makes all of the waveforms the same size. The only downside is if it's a quiet one, you get a little bit of hiss when it raises the volume. But I think you'll be okay. I think you're well within operating parameters. But yes, we are back. This is episode number 68 of the Rewatch Project, and we have reached the 18th episode of season 3 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., namely the episode The Singularity. So Hannah, please tell us what this episode is about.
Okay, so synopsis says, the S.H.I.E.L.D. team is left reeling and decimated as Hive continues to sway Inhumans to his side. But there is a sliver of hope as agents Fitz and Simmons follow a lead that may be able to stop the maniacal Inhuman once and for all.
Well, as long as there's a sliver of hope, that's the important thing, isn't it?
That's what we want.
And who are the key creatives behind
directed
this episode?
By Gary A. Brown.
Yep.
And written by Lauren LeFranc and DJ Doyle.
Cool, okay, so they've both got numerous episodes of...
Hardcore Marvel's AOSs.
Yes, they've got plenty under their belt. Excellent, okay, well, before we get into things, just a quick reminder, a little bit of housekeeping. Do check out our friends' shows, namely The Iron Sequel, His Film, Her Movie, Film Bastards, Shinstroker vs. Spencer Entertainment Landfill. And I'll mention The Good, The Bad and The Odd as well, because now we're no longer sort of bound by the covenant of Pod Syndicate. I can be a little bit more generous in the sort
and that's
of
a good
the
podcast.
Shows. So check those out. As always, we appreciate feedback at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com.
And I have some.
And you can send us, excellent, we'll get to that in a moment. And you can send us either just traditional emails or voicemails or voice memos or however you want to do it there. That would be great. Also, we are on social media, namely Instagram and Twitter, at RewatchProj. That's P-R-O-J on both of those. And also, just a quick reminder that we do always appreciate reviews at Apple Podcasts. That is a great way of bolstering our listenership, getting more feedback, and, motivating us to record more of these. And last but not least, if you listen to us on YouTube, then please like and subscribe and do tell your friends. So Hannah, yes, feedback, let's do this.
Okay, so I'll go through the YouTube comments first.
Okay.
This is on episode 66, Paradise Lost. Jack Dubbs said, I learned recently that Daniel Whitehall was earmarked for a cameo appearance in Avengers Endgame.
Oh, wow.
Apparently, it even got so far as the actor who plays him, Reed Diamond, being contacted to check for his availability. Shame it never came to pass.
Was Whitehall ever mentioned in any of the films? Or was he was he only in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.? I can't remember. Was he in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
I can't remember either.
Because that would be interesting, because we've said before that if you've got all these different factions of the MCU, you know, you've got the movies, you've got the Disney Plus shows, you've got the ABC shows, and then you've got the Netflix shows. And really, the only instance of something from one of the ABC shows, of which Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is one of them, making its way into the films, was the casting of Jarvis, the guy who played him in Agent Carter, showing up in Endgame in the 1970s flashback. That was one of the only times that the river has run the other way. So it would have been interesting. But please, avid listeners and MCU fans,
keep it coming,
because
I love all that stuff.
Let us know. I mean, I'll be curious, because we like the MCU films. We've watched we've watched all of them multiple times, but we're by no means experts. So let us know about
enthusiastic amateurs.
Yeah, exactly. But let us know about the character of Whitehall, because I'm curious to know, did he originate in the comics? Was he created for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. or was he in the MCU before that? Just, I'd be really curious to get a sense of the sort of the chronology of that character. So we can kind of see what that would have meant. You know, if they had got this actor to do it, would that have been a sort of, score one for the canonicity of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., yeah. You know?
This next comment is also on Paradise Lost. Silver Surfer says, May versus Guyera is one of my favourite fights of the series. Ming is known for doing most of her own stunts, and Mark Dacascos is a real karate and kung fu champion. Hope this message finds you both well.
He does, relatively. And
yes,
thank you.
Yes, there we are, we're on the mend.
And well, you can kind of mend. And you can kind of tell as well in that sequence that, you know, it's
oh, it's beautiful.
You know, there's less cuts, there's less of the tricks that you get. I mean, I'm sure obviously Ming Na Wen will use stunt doubles because there's insurance reasons, and you know, and there's different kinds of stunts as well. Just because you're well versed in martial arts doesn't mean that you know how to fall out of a window,
yeah,
or drive a car fast, you know. Yeah. But as
or
I say,
the potential for wire work, I mean,
yeah,
I would say it's quite a skilled thing,
yeah, absolutely. But again, it's not just, oh, you know, we don't think you can do it, but it's like if one of your actors puts their back out, then that could really fuck up production.
God, imagine how long the production would be stalled if it was me. Fucking months.
But that's the thing, you know. But if you can get it, some people can be replaced more quickly. Yeah. I know it sounds awful, but that's the truth.
Last YouTube comment is on episode 67, The Team. Jack Dubs says, The Team is probably my favourite episode from the second half of season 3.
It's a good one.
It's just a shame that a portion of its story was born out of necessity, chiefly to write Joey out of AOS so the actor Juan Pablo Raba could go off and star in the Narcos TV show for Netflix.
Oh, okay.
So that's interesting, actually, because, you know, he could have been built up to be something substantial within The Team.
Yeah.
Right.
God, they had a lot going on behind the scenes this season, didn't they?
They did. Okay, so we also have an email entitled Newish Listener.
Cool.
Hey guys, Rod from Missoula here. Fun fact, I was born in the same town as David Lynch. I think might get a kick out of that.
Missoula, Montana.
Just wanted to let you know that I am a newish listener. I found the show after starting a S.H.I.E.L.D. rewatch, as it's now on the Disney app here, and loving the show. I am in for the long haul and will follow you on whatever rewatch you do next.
Oh, cool.
Although, big shock, Twin Peaks would be my suggestion. There's only 30 episodes. Mm. You know it makes sense. Speak soon.
Yeah,
Rod.
Yeah, no, God. Preaching to the choir there, mate. And it's funny.
Twin Peaks is one of Mike's all-time favourite TV series. So
it's funny you mentioned Missoula, yeah. Because of course when spoiler alert for Twin Peaks, when Bob murders Maddie, he shouts, "Leland tells me you're going home to Missoula, Montana." You know, so I guess that's a
a massive spoiler.
Yeah, I just said spoiler alert for Twin Peaks.
Sorry, I didn't hear you say that.
I mean. I mean, Twin Peaks is one of those shows where, I mean, you'd have plenty to talk about, that's for sure. But also,
there's been some really great Twin Peaks podcasts.
Yeah.
Mark Kane, who is a feedbacker to the show.
Yeah, also yeah. Twin Peaks podcasting.
Right?
Yeah.
And Mike has guest appeared on that show to talk about a couple of key episodes.
Yeah.
As has Paul, your podcasting life partner.
Oh, he did an X-Files one.
Oh, did he?
Yeah,
oh,
he was on their X-Files show, but it was the same people, so...
Yeah, what was it called? The Twin Peaks podcast?
Twin Peaks Log or something like that. But just go to the Good, the Bad and the Odd site, because it's one of the spin-offs of that, and they're all in the same place.
Go and check it out, because that would be a good place to start.
Absolutely. And great to have a new listener.
Absolutely, keep it coming.
Yeah, and let us know if you've got any... anecdotes about spotting David Lynch. I mean, I don't know whether he's ever been back there or not, but I'll be curious to know. Okay, brilliant stuff. So, again, reminders, rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. We would always appreciate that. Should we get straight into this?
Yep, let's do it.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to hit pause, we're going to watch the episode, and then we're going to come back and we'll have a non-spoiler discussion of this. So we will just get cracking with The Singularity, episode 18 of season 3 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Chat soon.
Cue.
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, and welcome to Film Bastards, a podcast where three friends, two of them married and two of them podcasting life partners, chat everything from new releases, trailers, news, and an eclectic mix of other film goodies, oh, and many, many, many tangents. You can find them by searching your podcast provider or check them out on Twitter and Instagram by searching Film Bastards. You never know, you might like it. And if you don't, well, we don't really give a f***.
And we are back. So we have just watched for Singularity, number 18 of season 3 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Is that wrong?
I think it's 19. Sorry, no, you're right. It is 18. That's me.
Okay. So, Hannah, what were your initial thoughts?
I liked it. God, what were my initial thoughts? I really liked the episode. Mm-hmm. Really liked it. It wasn't one of your balls out action the whole time.
There were no balls out.
No,
that's
there were
correct.
No testicles showing.
Not even one.
Not even a hint of a hair on a ball.
No.
But equally,
it was a balls in.
But it wasn't slow either.
Yeah.
I love the fact that there was development in Fitz and Simmons' relationship, and it's great to get a bit of
Balls out in that department.
Well, there were about to be. There was potential balls out.
Yeah. Airing of balls.
I think it was just nice to see them not get scuppered for a change.
Well, I mean, I'll jump ahead. I thought that was going to happen, like, you know, when he came back. And I don't know whether they deliberately had him acting slightly out of character, because she's like, well, I came back to the rendezvous point, why didn't you?
I thought the same. We both watched Mission Impossible as well.
Well, no, not just that, but I thought it was going to be like a glowy eyes moment, Ethan, you know, like a ha ha ha.
4 o'clock, 4 a.m, Ethan.
You know, like Michael Jackson at the end of the Thriller video, when you think everything's fine, he turns around and he's like, no, you've... Then he turns around and looks at the camera, and he's got like the cat's eyes. And,
I think they made a robot in the 5 minutes that they had time.
Yeah, and like I thought that maybe he just got hived or something, because like he, you know, like he's like, oh, your hands are cold, you know, just how I like them. Like he was going to do something evil. But anyway, no, sorry. But so you were saying that you liked this episode. You liked those elements of it. Anything
it's
else?
Nice to see them not get scuppered.
Yep.
I like how they're portraying the addiction within Daisy as being a heightened emotion that she already feels.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's quite a interesting way to do it, because it's not unhinged obsession.
Yeah.
It's finding that need in... That desire in yourself and amplifying it, which is probably more true to life in terms of what people in addiction experience and have trouble giving up.
Mm. Well, and also, it's you can use it as things like religion. Or,
she says
or,
on her 94th gym.
Well, no, it's like it can also be allegorical for religion and cults and... New Age beliefs, you know, the idea that you get a comfort and kind of a high from this feeling of connection, whether it's connection to other people or connection to you know, an imagined deity or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So I think there's a little bit of that going on there as well.
Yeah. I thought it was really good. Surprisingly good, I think. Mm-hmm. It started off like, I don't think I was expecting there to be as much quiet development.
Well, that's the thing I've noticed about this season, is that a lot of the episodes, particularly the smaller episodes,
I don't remember this episode at all.
The thing I've noticed about this season is a lot of the episodes, like the quieter episodes, they've kind of got a natural sort of momentum to them.
Yeah.
Like a lot of them... Like, this started off, and I thought, oh, okay, it's going to be one of these episodes. And it kind of was, but it's a little bit like the episode a couple ago, the Paradise Lost one, where we got the story of Malik, where I thought, oh, okay, this is going to be a bit of background on him. Yeah. But by the end of it, you realised you were taken on a journey.
Yeah.
And I feel like this episode was a little bit like that. I mean, I'll just sort of go into what my thoughts were. I'm with you as well, in the way that this was very much one of those, you know, chessboard, moving the pieces episodes. And I think Lauren LeFranc has written a few of those. I think maybe that's kind of her thing. Or at least, I think there might, it might also
kind
be
kind of bringing threads together.
Yeah. Or it might also just be the fact that I think that there's probably, you know, like in any workplace, there's probably a pecking order.
Well, we've said that about Monica Owusu-Breen before as well, how she tends to be given, like, either an episode before a big episode or an episode after a big episode to kind of bring all those threads together.
What I'm getting at, though, is I don't think it's necessarily just this person's good at writing these types of episodes. I think there's a pecking order, probably.
Right.
As far as allocation of episodes goes, it's like, you know, the showrunners and, you know, their generals get the big episodes.
Yeah.
You know, so I think there's a little bit to that. So I think maybe there's perhaps a little bit of chicken and egg. I think maybe certain people get good at writing certain kinds of episodes because they're the types of episodes they get given. You know.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's 22 of these things a year, you know.
Yeah.
And it's interesting as well that this is another episode where it was credited on IMDb as being co-written by DJ Doyle. But you'll notice on screen it did just say Lauren LeFranc. That's the second time that's happened. So I suspect that maybe
I wonder if he's story edited.
Well, no, because I mean, you get a credited story editor anyway on this. No. But what I think it is I think that there's certain episodes where either because of time or whatever, I think he's the fix-it guy, maybe, on the show, who is kind of, because what you remember is the showrunners, who are writers, but they're having to produce the show. They're having to make sure that the trucks carrying the props are turning up, you know, that level of that. So I think that kind of, I get the feeling that DJ Doyle is their sort of manager, like show manager when it comes to the writing. So I think that when an episode either isn't working or has come in short or needs editing or there's a sudden practical change where they have to rewrite some of it because of an actor or something like that, that he's the person that they get in. And I think that sometimes they maybe don't credit him out of either respect for the person who wrote it, or maybe it's a union thing that you've got to have written X amount of words, you know, in order to get a credit, you know. It's but it's a thing.
That's probably more.
But so this was definitely one of those kind of moving the piece around the chessboard one. But I just think it was very well done, and I think that I'm kind of being a bit of a broken record here. But I think
it was really well done.
But I think that the show's got to a point now where they're so competent at making the show that even these kind of functional episodes are good.
Oh, I feel completely in safe hands. I don't go into an episode dreading what's coming because it's just not that show.
Yeah.
It's competent and the writers know what they're doing.
Yeah.
They've got a really good handle on it by now. It's season three.
And it never feels like they're treading water as well. I mean, the quieter episodes, they're only quieter in the sense that they're having to, as I say, move things around and get things in place. But that's interesting in its own right because that's often when the character stuff happens.
Yeah.
You know.
Yep. No, absolutely.
Should we get into it then? Yep. Should we get into the old breakdown? So, this was another one of those great, oh, I guess they're coming back, previously's on.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, so you're showing as the Aussie guy in Dakota that they went to see.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a bit of a, Faith's coming out of her coma kind of previously's. So what we see is that S.H.I.E.L.D. are on, they're on full red alert because obviously there's been a, you know, Sky's gone full sort of like brainwashed quake out on them. And we learn that she's taken some Terrigen and a couple of other sort of artifacts that will be useful to her. We see Coulson giving a pep talk to the team.
Yeah.
And it's a great little, one of the things I like is obviously as well as the little bumper scene at the end that they always have, they usually like to do something kind of fun and pacey before the, not the opening credits, but before the logo. Mm. And this week sees a cool, a special effects shot of the plane having to kind of sidle out of the base.
And you love the fact that Wim May's explaining he's had an idea, but it's kind of dangerous.
Yeah.
How, you know,
she's
really
it.
Excited.
Yeah, yeah. She's like, this is where I live.
Yeah.
And we see Daisy and Ward together. And it's interesting as well, because she gets a little bit of an insight into Ward in the way that, I mean, there's no reason, considering they're sort of symbiotic, there's no reason or even ability for Hive to lie about Ward to her. So basically, this is probably in some ways the purest, most trustworthy insight into Ward we get in the entire show.
Exactly. Because it's quite a dispassionate look at him.
Yeah.
You know, Hive doesn't fear Ward.
Yeah, but he knows him as well as he knows himself.
Yeah, he's
but
just
he doesn't have an agenda or, you know, isn't insane, at least not in the same way that Ward was.
No.
And basically what he says is that Ward was fond of her, and also that Ward was glad to die.
Yeah.
You know, and that's quite interesting.
I thought that was a nice thing to say, because I agree with that. Like,
he wasn't a happy person.
No, as much as he was, you know, quote marks, the bad guy, he was a product of his life.
He was damaged goods.
Yeah, and he knew he was damaged goods.
Yeah, yeah.
He knew that he was a fucked up individual.
Just bouncing from one thing to another.
And
almost.
Just kind of got to a point where he was like, oh, well, hashtag fuck it,
yeah.
I'm going to embrace it.
Yeah, he just became almost like a dark game
yeah.
to him by that point.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
The only thing he had left.
Like,
you know?
He thought he was too far gone.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like, well, I may as well kind of...
just go with it.
Get some sport out of it, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that's pretty much what it comes down to.
Yeah.
He mentions about how infested inhumans are impervious as well.
Yep.
Like, we learn that this kind of adrenalized state that they're in when they're being, you know, possessed or whatever you want to call it.
They're being infected.
Yeah, exactly. Sort of renders them impervious.
So no ices can be used on them.
Yes, exactly. Well, and real guns won't work either, or will be less effective. We learn about a Dr. Radcliffe, who's played by John Hannah. We see the picture.
Yep.
Probably most well known for Four Weddings and a Funeral.
Indeed.
And
Stop the Clocks.
Yeah, Stop the Clocks. And in this house, as Batiatus in Spartacus.
An old sliding doors dude.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he was great in Spartacus. He has some of the best swearing ever. I mean, by Jupiter's cock is a...
No, what is it? Your words fall like shit from arse.
No, the words fall from your mouth like shit from arse. And she's nothing. Shit from a whore. That was another one of my... Oh, another one as well. Why do the gods fuck me? And he's like, I always think about that. If something goes wrong at work, in my head, I just think, oh. And I remember my friend Ian in Birmingham, he always used that line as well. And I remember sometimes somebody would go wrong and he'd be like, why do they fuck us, Mike? Why do the gods fuck us? But yeah, so we basically what we learn is that he's into some dodgy kind of transhumanism, which is basically like it's a classic, I think William Gibson and Philip K. Dick and all of the kind of the great cyberpunk writers talk about this. The idea that inevitably technology and biology and religion and philosophy and theology, all the ologies, archaeology.
It's Dr. Frankenstein.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I mean, and it's worth pointing out that Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is generally regarded as the first ever science fiction novel.
Because
people think of it as horror, but it's science fiction. I mean,
of course it is.
You look at science fiction as being speculative fiction, then that's the ultimate science fiction story. So, yes, so they learn that there's some dodgy transhumanism going on, and they send the Fitzsimmons team to get him.
Let's get him.
Let's get him. Let's get the fucker.
I'm gonna fucking get you.
We see a little bit of awkwardness between Fitz and Simmons, and I like the fact that
she's... Did you think as well, sorry, before that, that there seemed to be some awkwardness between Fitz and... shit, what's his name? Mac.
No, I think it was more...
When he said, oh, you're being very quiet or something.
Yeah, no, I think what you're starting to see is Mac taking on more of a leadership role.
Yeah.
And I think that it was just that he's got... I think that they wanted the audience to see that Mac's starting to feel a bit of a burden of all of that.
Yeah.
So there was a bit of a...
Maybe not burden, maybe responsibility.
Yeah. Yes and no then, I guess. I mean, I think that there was a bit of awkwardness there, but I think that it's explained away, you know, in the plot.
It's just something that stood out to me, and for a minute I was thinking, shit, did I miss something? Did they have a fight in the last episode? But they didn't.
No, it wasn't anything like that.
No.
So I like the fact as well that Simmons is like, what you mean once we have sex? Because he's talking about how things could change. And
he's being all coy about it because there's someone behind you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
and we it's funny how, particularly after you mentioned it the other week, Daisy points out to Zombie Ward that he keeps calling her Sky.
Yeah,
and Hannah mentioned that that makes sense because he wouldn't have known, and they actually have a conversation about it as well, which is
And I hadn't realised that they'd actually addressed that.
Hadn't when you said that.
No, I know, but it was nice to see that they referenced that they don't just leave it for something to kind of spot
or just not do it at all.
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, there have been maybe one or two geeks on the internet going, well, hang on, he's calling her Daisy. But I think a lot of shows would have just hand waved that, you know, and I think it's nice that they didn't, you know. And I think that's, you said as much.
I mean, that's a testament to the writers that they care about that shit.
Yeah, exactly, That, you know, that they think about it. And we see that Talbot's a bit pissed off because basically he, you know, kind of rightfully, I think, thinks that Coulson's a bit of a flake. He's not seeing things through.
And well, not that he's a flake. I think that he's pushing his own agenda.
Yeah, well, it's that he's not seeing things through. He's jumping onto the next problem.
He's jumping onto the problem that he sees as most important because it affects his team.
Exactly, and he tellingly, he hasn't told Talbot about Daisy. So we see that they're looking for Alicia, the Inhuman, who she's the one from an earlier episode who can split herself into multiple people. And they want to get her before Hydra do, well, before the villains do.
Hive does.
Yeah, exactly. So we go over to Bucharest, where the team Fitzsimmons are looking for the good doctor. We see that Lincoln wants to go on the mission. There's a great little exchange where basically Coulson's like, okay, well, you can go. But you've got to wear this vest because it will explode if you get caught, because we can't have any human being taken alive by Hive.
Yeah.
And I like the fact that he's like, so you want me to wear a suicide vest? And he's like, well, no, a suicide vest is something that you control. And he's like, so it's a murder vest.
Yeah.
You know, he's like that's...
And I mean, quite rightly, it is a bit like, fucking hell, Coulson.
Yeah. No, but I get it. It's like the spies have like cyanide tablets and...
You totally do get it, but I can't see him ever having told Daisy that she had to wear a murder vest.
And he says that it's just in case. I like that they're at the party and we've got some classic spy glasses going on here as well. And we learn that there's lots of genetically altered people at the party as well. So it's all very, as I say, all very William Gibson, Philip K. Dickish.
Mm-hmm. Very Dickish.
I always think of, that's like gaslighting, that's Blade Running. And that's a Philip K. Dick move. It's a real Philip K. Dick move, that
I
is.
I like that.
Gaslighting is when you convince a woman she's crazy, and Blade Running is when you convince a woman she's an android. It's like, are you finding gaslighting just too easy and not a challenge anymore? Try and convince a woman she's an android.
Is that what you were doing to me? Because we've already worked out that I've got a cold, dark heart.
Yeah, hey, look, there's an aim to fucking malfunction, Hannah. We can get through this. So May gets pissed off with Coulson and basically says that he's a hypocrite by getting her essentially to do all the dirty work. Doesn't want to get his hands dirty, she says. We see Sky
and
go,
she quite rightly calls him out, and she is the only person who can do that to him.
Yeah, absolutely. And Sky goes to, surprise, surprise, because of the previously, goes to see the Aussie guy, and her and Ward terrorgen him. we see the four part Inhuman woman pulls a gun on Lincoln, who goes to see her, and she starts to go a bit Magneto and talk about humans being the lesser species, but she's been lynched.
She's all hived.
Yep, and
Hives up on hives.
She's Hive essentially makes her kill her, well, one of herself, and Coulson shoots the other one. It's almost as though when Coulson shoots the other one, it's almost as though he's like, "See, I can get my fucking hands dirty." You know, it's almost like a kind of a
see.
We see the Aussie character transform outside. He's
into Burning Man.
Yeah, into Burning Man, and. He shows them where the buried artifact is, and basically,
should we call him Bernie Sanders?
Bernie Sanders, Bernie Taupin. So he points out that Ward Hive points out that this is the only thing that can destroy him.
He could be weakened at Bernie's.
Oh God! Jesus Christ! Take a break now. You like to sit back and enjoy the rest of your drink.
Oh God, yes.
So they try to get an appointment with the. That's funny. They try to get an appointment with the doc, but they try to get to see the John Hannah character. We see that Coulson has. He takes Lincoln out of the field. Basically, yeah. He's like
realizes he was being a bit of a dick about
it. Yeah, exactly. And May basically, well, she explicitly says to Coulson, "You're not Sky's father. You're not Daisy's father." And he says she's the closest he has to a daughter. So it's nice to see
that. He acknowledges that he knows he's not her father.
Yes, yeah.
But that for him, she is like a daughter.
Yeah, and it's the most explicit sort of confrontation or highlighting of that we've seen in the show,
It's showing that he realises that he's got that parental unconditional love.
Yeah.
Like, you know, when he's saying to the team right at the start of the episode about not to kill Daisy and how she hasn't done anything wrong and this isn't of her making, and it sounds like a parental speech, like they're a good kid, really.
Yeah.
Give them another chance.
Yeah, that's it. She's not normally like this. So you also get the double meaning of the naming of the episode as well when... Fitz tells Simmons about how he feels that the crux of their relationship is like a singularity.
Yeah.
You know, that as soon as they deviate from a path, things become wrong. So basically what she's saying is, look, you need to just stop thinking about this, because they're talking about sex and about how their relationship will be changed after that.
Well, he's saying to her that he acknowledges he needs to stop thinking about
it. Yeah, absolutely. They get ushered into the room and basically get put on the spot with some eye surgery. And she's... Simmons,
which you said you were pleased you hadn't seen before your eye surgery.
Yeah. God, yeah, I was very sensitive to that kind of thing around there. So she sticks a needle into the eye, and then we see that it's John Hannah and that he's already got a prosthetic eye and that, he's...
And it was a test within a test.
Yeah, exactly. May and Coulson go to Dakota, and we see, Coulson hobbling about. He's still recovering from his injury from the previous episode.
Totally relate.
And we see that they see that Hive have unearthed something. Mm. The Team Fitzsimmons get rumbled, and the John Hannah character realises that they're on comms with somebody. Matt goes in, basically, they tell him, look, we need somebody who can stop a mad alien parasite, is the phrase that they use. And I like the fact that Fitz kind of kicks ass in the scene as well.
Yeah, he does.
Like, he does push back against a couple of people. It's as though he's nothing...
He breaks one guy's leg,
nothing sort of in, like... He doesn't suddenly become John Wick, but, you know, he's been out in the field now for a few years. So he's starting to pick up
it's a nice reminder that he's come through the other side of his rehab from,
his injuries and
the injury when, the brain injury, massive brain injury that he had. There was so many doubts that he was ever going to be a part of the team again.
Particularly when you consider that he's the brains of the group,
yeah.
Or part of the brains of the group. I like the fact that there's still a bit of time for a bit of bants between May and Coulson, where he talks about his leg hurts, and she's like, "We'll get a cybernetic one," and he's like, "Oh, too soon."
Yeah.
Daisy rocks up to.
In effect, he has a shield.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, yes, yes, absolutely. So Daisy rocks up to Fitz, and Ward rocks up to Simmons.
Sorry, just to interrupt you, I was just going to say I like the fact that it is a shield like Captain America's shield, yeah, because he is such a Steve Rogers geek.
Well, Captain America's shield was made by S.H.I.E.L.D. It was made by SSR.
Yeah, no, so. I know, but he has the baseball card.
Yeah,
the Avengers
film. Of course it would be like his. Yeah.
It's not like fucking Thor's hammer or anything like that.
Yeah, totally,
it's got to be Captain America's shield.
It's nice. It's consistent with his character. You're absolutely right. And we see the Aussie in the bar starting shit. That's which is probably the most realistic moment in this episode in many ways, isn't it?
All he needed to do was ask for a couple of flaming sandbookers.
Yeah,
being very true to
exactly.
Life.
So he brings Will out, and I think it's funny as well about how he because what we're seeing, of course, we saw in a previous episode, is that Hive has the memories of the people beforehand. Mm. So, for example, with Malik's brother. So what we see is a really sort of kind of psychologically manipulative scene where Hive is eliciting the memories of Will and speaking to Simmons as Will.
And that's like one of the most dangerous things about Hive as a character, is that he has all of these important people's memories to manipulate with.
Yeah, and also, I mean, just the sort of strategic element of it. And it's funny because she rightly says, just because you have his memory, you've stolen his memories, doesn't mean, you're him. It's like in, movies where the vampire will suddenly look like the person again and be like, hey, come to me. And they're like, no, you're not really them. You know, that classic sort of sci-fi thing. There's a little bit of that going on here. And I like the fact...
Great performance there, by the way.
Yeah, I've already got a sort of method there.
No, you're not really him.
Yeah, you're not my son. But there's a really nice bit of acting as well from Chloe Bennett when she's sort of force-choking Fitz, and you can see...
And her eyes are welling up.
Yeah, like she's being all sort of like, threatening.
She's being a hard ass, but she kind of doesn't like that she's being a hard ass.
Yeah, it's a bit like the spoiler for Breaking Bad, but it's a bit like that great scene in Breaking Bad near the end when Bryan Cranston is having the conversation with his wife and he's saying one thing, but he doesn't mean it. And you're seeing he's on the phone with her.
Yeah.
And you're seeing visually.
Oh, he's being a real asshole
like,
to her.
Visually,
on the phone.
You're seeing the truth.
Yeah.
But verbally, it's not. And to be able to kind of separate out a performance like that is, and she's doing that in this scene to her credit. I think it's great that the taking down of Hydra is such a minor thing, like the way
it's really
that,
minor.
Like when May walks in, she's like, "What's going on?" It's like, "Oh, they're going to take down Hydra. Want to watch?" And it reminds me of whenever you see this behind the scenes footage of like American presidents sort of in the Situation Room, sat there with their people. Watching a plasma screen of them going, of them getting, some
Bin Laden.
Yeah. It's got that kind of like, right, that's done, let's eat, kind of,
Yeah.
It feels like it's eliciting that. Basically, because obviously what's happened is what Coulson says is that they made the mistake of fucking with, Malik's family. You when you do that, any allegiance that you've got is gone.
Yeah.
So what they've got is all of Malik's. Malik had so much intel on the surviving Hydra that Ward, Zombie Ward, had kind of used that they take them down. Simmons makes it back to the hotel. She tells Mac that. She tells Mac about what in a moment there about her relationship with Simmons and it's with Fitz, and it's funny because she's like, "Oh, it's all so new," and he's like, "No, it isn't." And it's kind of like, it is new to them, but he's obviously.
But he also is privy to how Fitz has felt about Simmons.
Well, not just that. I think that's definitely part of it. You're absolutely right, but I think also sometimes people are the last people to realise their own feelings. Sometimes it's more obvious to everyone else, you know. That, you know, it's that, oh, you like them, don't you? No!
Yeah.
And then it's like, oh, shit, do I, you know?
Yeah.
So Hydra has been eliminated, just like that. And then we end the episode with what I thought was going to be Fitz showing evil eyes, but actually they just get it on. And absolutely. When I wrote that note, get it on, I thought, I'm going to hear Hannah do that thing. We see Betty Artis and the Inhumans. A great band name, by the way, if you want it.
Betty Artis and the Inhumans. Yeah.
And but what we learn is, and this is a nice, because I thought they'd forgotten about this thread, where you got the Mark Dacascos character talk about how the...
I'll be snookering you.
Oh my God, there's something I haven't thought about for a while. It was a nice callback to what the Mark Dacascos character said in the last episode about all of Malik's money.
Yeah.
And Ward has bought a town.
Yeah.
Basically, for some nefarious means. So, Hannah, if you want to bring up the details for the next episode.
I've got it, really.
Any final thoughts on this one before we do the last bit?
No, just a really fun episode with more gravitas than you probably think at the start of it.
Yeah.
Really enjoyed it.
Yeah, move things along and move them along nicely, I would say. Quick reminder that we appreciate emails, by the way, at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, whether they are old school typed emails or voice memos, MP3s, however you want to do it. Also, at rewatchproj, that's rewatchproj on Instagram and Twitter. Also, check out the Iron Sequel, His Film, Her Movie, Film Bastards, Gin Stroker vs. Punter, and Entertainment Landfill, all of our friends' podcasts, Good, Bad, and the Odd as well. Check those guys out too. Hi, Mark, if you're listening. We want feedback from you. I haven't heard from you in a while.
Where's your next voice back?
And Apple Podcast reviews and likes and subscribes on and comments on YouTube. So, Hannah, what are we talking about next time?
Okay, the next episode is number 19, Failed Experiments. Plot synopsis says, as the threat of Hive looms, loyalties are put to the test and the team must come up with a decisive resolution.
So we've got, including next week's, that's four episodes, I think, remaining?
Let's have a look. 1, 2, 3, 4, yes.
Cool, we're getting there.
The next episode is directed by Wendy Stansler and written by Brent Fletcher, and DJ Doyle has got a story editor credit.
I don't want to curse anything, but I've got a feeling that certainly by the time we get to the last couple of episodes of the season, I reckon we'll record them pretty soon back to back, won't we? Because I think once we've watched the penultimate episode, we're going to want to watch the next episode pretty soon afterwards, aren't
look,
we?
Look, I'd quite happily just go boom, boom, boom the next few nights, but you know.
There's too much good TV. I mean, Christ, let's think about this. We've got, Moon Knight was on tonight. We've still not watched that. We've got two Better Call Sauls that we haven't watched.
Yeah.
Bloody Star Trek's on tomorrow night. It's just too much to do.
Such a hard life. We're also about halfway through season 2 of Lower Decks.
Yes, and we've been rewatching Fringe as well. We're midpoint on season 3, are we? Or?
Oh no, we're near the end.
Oh, we're near the end.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow, God, we've been blasting through that then, haven't we?
Yeah, yeah.
Just so much TV.
Oh, God, there's so much TV. But don't worry, we'll always carve out time for the Rewatch Project.
We will. Once or twice a week, without fail, we'll get there. But anyway, that's us for this week, guys. So please do make contact with us in one of those ways that we outlined earlier. Check out all of those other shows, and we will see you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.